said without telling you. So what we're going to do is the one you just heard, and then move now with measured sound, and then when Laura smiles. And the rest of the program, you will be relieved to know, is every. Move now with measured sound is a little theater piece. And you will hear a reference to dancing trees. Elizabeth's whole court liked to ride out to the woodland and spend the whole day like jousting and playing Robin Hood and hunting and dancing and singing. And often there were these little theatrical presentations. So as we play this opening, you can imagine some courtiers dressed as trees moving out in the graceful pavane.
Diana's eyes are not adorned.
John Daniel, who is the brother of the great Elizabethan poet Samuel Daniel, who wrote the text. And it's a kind of a brilliant song because it's full of musical metaphors. The singer actually cues off of the lute part will say something, the singer picks it up and presents it to the audience as a metaphor. It's really, it's a beautiful song.
say a few words about the lute that I'm playing today. This is a copy of an instrument in a museum in Bologna. It's an 8-course lute, circa 1610. You can see the almond-shaped back there of the instrument. This is made out of yew wood, okay? And the front of the instrument, the soundboard, is made out of alpine spruce, and the neck is of ebony, and the bridge is of pear wood. So a number of fine woods used to make up this lute. The strings are made of gut. Gut has that special magical sound that the humanists and philosophers marveled at. Shakespeare perhaps saying it best, "Is it not strange that sheep's guts should hail men's souls from their bodies?" He didn't say nylon, he said sheep's guts. And the frets are also made of gut, and these frets are movable too. You can actually, unlike the guitar, you can move them into position to get subtle gradations of sound and fine-tune certain chords. And you'll notice that the neck is bent back like this. Often people ask me, why is it so? Well, think about it. You could just put it straight down on the table like this. The table was the center of the musical world in the Renaissance and the Baroque. Most music making occurred around the table. So I brought my little card table.
Yeah.
song called Fly From the World, which is about the soul longing for the release of death. And in it, there was a strong metaphor about the soul as a sailing ship, sailing for home. We're about to do another one of these songs. Most of the lute songs were secular, but Thomas Campion, doctor of physic, that's how he signed his name, published a couple of books of what he called divine and moral songs. So some of them are religious and some of them just have some moral character. Campion was equally famous as a poet as he was as a composer, maybe the last composer in Western music history to be equally famous for his poetry. And the worldview expressed in his divine songs is very sweet. It's very accepting, and it's always about cheer up, don't despair.
Thank you.
but God his own will guard, and bear sharp pain and grief in time assuage. Sin and death, hell and tempting fiends may rage, but God his own will guard, and bear sharp pain and grief in time.
delighted that you came for the first time, but not for the last time. I know that you were willing to entertain questions, so if anyone has a question before we adjourn for a snack, please ask.
Page 2, please. Were any of the Shakespearean sonnets set to music?
Sonnets? I don't think so. Excerpts from them sometimes, but
I can't recall all the offhand, but we knew of a lot of the songs in the plays, obviously. For example, the first song on our program, It Was a Lover and His Last, was set as a lead song in Thomas Morley's Book of Airs from 1600.
And you probably recognize the Willow song.
And the Willow song, sung by Othello. Sung by Desdemona and Othello.
And were these songs ever presented other than by a solo singer, in other words, two or more singers?
Oh, yeah.
Well, you'll find in this period songs arranged for four singers, for example. You know, these lute songs can be sung with the lute accompanying a solo voice, or around a table with four singers, or even more.
Some Capion songs are set with two voices. They varied, and then sometimes you just do them as instrumentals. And the composers invited that in their prefaces because they wanted their songs to be heard. So they would say, these can be done with lute, they can be done with viols, they can be done like that.
You could do it any which way. Just buy our book.
Were you improvising?
Some notes were improvised.
Half and half during some
of those? Yeah, in this type of music, it's like jazz. Mm-hmm. And when Marsha and I play, there's an interplay going on. So she'll do something and I'll react to it.
If I do an ornament, Chris often picks it up and vice versa.
It seemed like in the piece that you were doing yourself, the solos, it sounded like a lot of improvising in some of those.
The composer was skillful enough to write it in such a manner that it sounds improvised. And a lot of these are written down improvisations. That's
true to say. There's a lot of preponderance of death in most lute music. Why is that during the Renaissance?
That's an interesting question. Yeah, there is some, the lute was very close to this idea of moving the soul of the listener. And often you'll find funereal music arranged for lute and voice or other instruments. They often played lutes at funerals, to send the soul off in a good way.
I read somewhere where Elizabeth herself loved this thing.
She loved the lute. She had several lutenists at her court, in her privy chamber. She had what she called the musicians of the three lutes, always at her beck and call.
We know she played some lute because she received lute strings as a New Year's gift, as a common news gift. Also, melancholy was a fashionable humor at this time. It was fashionable to be melancholy and dark, and as Pat Brown says, show her how sensitive you are. Dowland was like the king of melancholy. He was famous for it.
Semper Dowland.
Where is he living a happy life himself?
He's always sad.
We think so. Hard to say, really.
Yes.
I'm fascinated by the instrument. How many strings does it have?
The lute. This particular one, I should say, has 15 strings. I have other lutes that have less or more, but this particular one has 15. The top is usually strung single. We call that the chanterelle, like on the violin. It's the singing string. And that's the one that usually carries the melody. Yes?
Just one more question. How close is your harp to a contemporary harp?
Not very. These are so different than the big pedal harps you see on the concert stage. I've never actually had my hands on pedal harp. They use a completely different technique. They're using the large muscle groups. You recognize this posture. When you're playing a pedal harp, your elbows are up and you're using the shoulders and the lats and the delts and stuff. With early harpers, it's all right down here. It's all the small muscles. And apart from the form, you recognize the form, but the chromatic harps are a really very different prospect. These are both Flemish, 15th century Flemish harps, and we know from iconography that this type of harp continued to be used in consort playing right up through the 17th century.
Was any music written for the lute after the Renaissance?
Yes. Yeah, it was...
Who?
Well, you know, Weiss, I want to box, exact contemporary, actually. He's the most prolific composer.
Weiss?
So that he was Leopold Weiss, yes. Wrote more than 900 pieces. there's a lot of the repertoire for the lute. There's almost a lifetime of music to play. It's one of the most neglected instruments of Western culture, actually. And there's more music for it than any other instrument of its time.
There was also a Haydn contemporary named Hagen who wrote beautiful things for the lute. And his real job was he was concertmaster at Bayreuth. So he's really a fiddle player, but he loved the lute. He continued to write for it. Some watch for Hagen records. Robert Bartow has a beautiful one out on the Koch, no, the label in Canada, Koch, but Norbert Crafts. I can't remember. I'll remember it until you later.
Any connection between the lute and the castrato?
They used to come to themselves a lot. For example, that Caravaggio painting of the lute player.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The boy in that painting looks very effeminate, and he's sitting there holding a lute, mm-hmm. playing at a small table like here. They often accompany themselves, these singers in private performance. So you had players like that, singers like that, who would study how to play instruments as well as sing powerfully. Question.
What does the title Philip's Dump mean?
You know, it's funny you should ask. I went to the competition in England for the BBC. It was a young musician competition. And there was another piece with the same similar title. It was called The Queen's Dump. And I'll never forget, I was playing in England there, playing this piece, and they announced it to the audience. It was broadcast live. And the Queen happened to be present, you know, and all the audience laughed at all of a sudden. Now they'll be playing a piece by John Johnson, a member of the Queen's Privy Chamber, entitled The Queen's Dump. But it's actually dump in this period. They looked into it. You could be down in the dumps, like Marshall was saying, melancholy was very much a part of the Elizabethan psyche. You know, I'm in the dumps. I feel a feeling like I'm in the weather or down or melancholy. And another recently found definition for dump was reverie, a dream state. So it could be that this piece referred to a kind of reverie, Philip's reverie, Philip's dump. It's imagination being at work in this piece.
There's one musical thing that they have in common is they are all based on an ostinato or a ground, which is a repeating bass pattern or harmonic pattern.
Usually 1-5.
There also is some theory that they may have been processions because they tend to have this duple meter, and they could have been funerary processions. That's just a theory, though. I can attribute it to Ron Cook in Columbus, Ohio.
John Warthog.
Well, you've taught us a lot and entertained us beautifully, and we thank you once again.